afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Sociology 315. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on the cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we're broadcasting three classes: Organizational Communications, Communications 300, on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Sociology 315, the Sociology of Work, on Saturdays from noon to 2 p.m. And Labor 412, Labor Law, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you can earn a bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then you will start over. If you would like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. Hi, everybody, and welcome back to our discussion of work. We have a new guest in the class, and it is a fly in the studio. So if you see me doing all of these little motions, I'm trying to kind of get it out of my life a little bit. Today we're going to kind of finish up our discussion on immigration, and then we're going to move forward and begin our discussion on organizations. And before we go on, I want to thank our guest speaker, Mr. Cabrera. And what is interesting is I got a lot of emails about his visit and the topic, and there were some questions that we didn't get to. And so I kind of want to start off there and finish up our discussion of immigration and begin to have you think about how these things are working socially in our lives. And before we begin, let me try one time to get rid of this fly. If you hear me inhale something, it's probably going to be bad. I want to finish up talking about immigration, but before we get started, I want to talk about the test and the book and all the different stuff for your readings. When I initially read this book, I really liked it, and it was very unique because I thought it gave a really good cross-cultural perspective on sociology of work. It outlined all of the concepts, but what I'm finding now is that this is a difficult book to use as a textbook because there is so much information. And so what I'm going to do in the next couple of days, sometime this week, this weekend, I'm going to give you a really detailed study guide. And so I'm going to pinpoint you to specific pages in the book that have information that I want you to know. Because I know once you're reading, and this is a really kind of challenging read, and so it's a lot to take in. And I want to remind you that we're not going detail by detail in the book. And basically what we're doing is pulling out some things and then looking at it in terms of the social consequences in society. So keep that in mind. Don't freak out. Your study guide is going to really target for you some important points that you need to know for the class. So I wanted to address that particular issue. And also, I've been keeping up on the discussion, and Blackboard has been acting a little weird this week, so I don't know if you guys have had some trouble. I've had a few emails saying that the course didn't come up for some people, or they couldn't post. And so during the course of the semester, we will kind of work out all of those glitches. So bear with us a little bit as we kind of go through the system. The school is going to change systems a little bit, so I don't know if it's causing some of the technical difficulties that we're experiencing. And also, I posted on Blackboard your pop quiz. And this pop quiz should have been very easy, because what I wanted you to really focus in on was the main points of what Richard was trying to say. And there's a lot in the books you could have read on McDonaldization, but he makes a consistent argument in all of the different books. And those songs that were posted, and we'll talk a little bit about them. I'll post some information on the grades and how everyone did on the course announcements. So let's get going, because I really want to get to the conversation today. But I wanted to finish up our conversation about immigration. And the last set of questions that we got in the class were related to Mexican immigration. And one of the interesting things about this is when we talk about immigration, we tend to now focus specifically on this group. And for California, I'm going to show you a little, in a little while, why. And so I want to get out some points, because the views on whether immigration is good or immigration is bad were really, really split. And some of the emails that I got from you guys were also really, really split on the perspective. So I'm going to kind of set California immigration in context so you can understand the diversity of ideas that people have out there. And I want you to remember, one of the things is that the U.S. has always had an immigration issue. And it started from the very beginning when the colonists landed, and we will probably continue to have an immigration issue as the world becomes more globalized. And for Mexicans, immigration has always been very problematic, just like the Chinese, just like other groups that came here specifically to work. Once the work was done, the people in the society, we didn't know if we should send these people back. And this situation has occurred multiple times. During the Depression, Mexicans and Mexican Americans were deported and blamed for the economic problems. So the issues that we're hearing regarding Mexican immigration is not new. So I want to take a look at our first clip, and I want you to think about what is assumed and what is actually taken for granted in this very, very short clip of this whole thing. So run the clip.
For example, Mr. Andrews, a South Texas truck farmer, is visited by a man from Minnesota.
Good morning, Bobby. I was just driving through South Texas and thought I'd like to see how you raise those winter vegetables we've been enjoying up in Minnesota this winter.
Well, here they are. Baker's up north.
Well, you're doing us people up north a big favor by raising all these winter vegetables.
Well, you're doing us a favor by buying our crop, so I reckon that makes us value.
Have you lived here long?
Only about 10 years. I used to be an office man in Ohio, but I heard about what you might call this new frontier they're opening up down this way. Well, the proposition looked good. I bought 30 acres. Right over there is the house we built after the family moved down.
In the Andrews home, problems of marketing the crop are now uppermost. Mr. Andrews keeps in close touch with daily market reports through the local newspaper.
Remind me to get in touch with Jim Fraser at the packing shed tomorrow. We have about 100 bushels of cabbage ready for market.
Have you heard how the market is on cabbage today?
It's up a little. Think we'd better sell a ton tomorrow.
Dad, how much did you pay for this farm?
$300 an acre, son. Why?
Well, Green and I decided to save our money and buy some uncleared land about 8 miles out. We can get it for $50 an acre and clear ourselves.
Well, look it over, but before you buy, you'd better make absolutely sure that you're in the irrigation district.
Yes, and how much irrigation did you do it will cost? Yes, and you'd better get samples of soil and have them analyzed.
Yes, I know all these things, and there are a lot more problems. We've been studying in school. But I like farming here, where you hardly ever have a crop failure.
Turning from problems of the future to those of the present, next morning we find Mexican workers in Mr. Andrews' cabbage field. Mexican labor is cheap. That is one reason why northern consumers pay so little for winter vegetables. Entire families labor in the fields. This young lad is picking beans with the skill of his elders beside him, working from early morning until sundown on his knees between the rows of plants. In a nearby field, plows have turned up the ripened potatoes, and other Mexican laborers are carefully putting them up in sacks. In this large carrot field, Mexican workers are brought in from their homes by trucks. The crop must be harvested quickly while the market is favorable. Hundreds of workers are engaged in harvesting these carrots at top speed. And this is why the housewife in any northern community, passing through the deep snow that covers all the countryside, has only to drive a few blocks to the nearest market to find there, in midwinter, a delightful offering of fresh vegetables. Because of refrigeration, rapid transportation, and the winter work of the southern truck farmer.
Transportation, the work of the truck farmer. They actually did mention the reason those crops are also there and also fresh has to do with the Mexican migrant workers that are working on the crops. So this film from the 1930s just takes as an assumption, it's not even anything special to consider the fact that Mexican labor is cheap labor. And children, adults, generations upon generations, this was what was expected. And so when we think about this going all the way back to the 30s, and we move forward today, one of the things that a lot of Americans don't want to admit is that we actually still rely a great deal on this labor. But when I was preparing for this lecture, I started looking around for information on quantity of workers, and what I found was one article that talks about Seattle, Washington, and this article says that there are about 125 seasonal workers in the Washington orchards, fields, and farms, and just big cherries alone requires about 20,000 workers, and one of the farmers said, I don't know what we would do without this immigrant labor pool. And so the result of this reality is that one of the congressmen, U.S. Senator Patty Murray, and Republican Representative Richard Hastings and Jennifer Dunn complained to the INS because their constituents were complaining to them because of all of the immigration raids. And in Washington, they were really tackling these raids. They were going to offices, to farms, and deporting a lot of people. Well, the farmers said, we won't have any crops harvested. If you continue to do this, if you continue to take these workers off of our farms, we are not going to be able to bring these crops to market. And so what is really interesting is the double-edged sword of this debate. When we talk about this idea of immigration, the Labor Department estimates that the total number of jobs in our economy that are require short-term training will increase from 53.2% to about 53.2 million to about 60.9 million in 2010. So this idea of these unskilled jobs or semi-skilled jobs are actually going to increase, and we need to have a population to meet this. Who is going to do this work? And one of the things I find very interesting about people who critique immigration is that there isn't an argument for this particular question. Some of you ask that question, and it's kind of like both sides, because Americans do not want to do agricultural labor, and kids that go to school, kids that go to 4 years of college, what do you tell your kids? Go forth and get a professional career. You don't tell your kids to go forth and become farmers. And so this issue of Mexican immigration is really unique because we need the workers, but we're still having a problem with this population coming into this country. And in 1949, the Border Patrol actually seized about 280 illegal immigrants. And this was in something called Operation Wetback. And this was when the Border Patrol gathered all of the Mexican, any Mexican workers, and some that were not illegal. And basically, pack them up and send them back to Mexico. And in some cases, these immigrants were deported along with their children born in the United States. And so this is not, you know, this issue is not a new issue. We just have to come to terms with the fact that we need the labor in this country. I was thinking about this and I thought, well, how do I really sum this up? And how do we put this in perspective? And the reality is here is that this is truly a double-edged situation. And the goal of this class, one of the problems I also have with this book, is that we want to talk about the social consequences of the class. And so we need to understand those consequences as it relates to work. So the benefits, basically, this is work that is getting done that American people do not want to do. And I hear people complain, but I am a rural sociologist and I've done studies of farms, farm life, and our relationship to farming and society. And basically, this is not something that Americans see as a high status position. We have a question of Rosa. So people want their fruits and veggies, but aren't willing to have the labor workers come to harvest them. And that's basically a good point, because that's exactly the reality of what's going on. Some of the benefits of this migrant labor do work people don't want to do. Increased diversity and uniqueness in the United States, provide humanitarian opportunities and economic opportunities for our neighbors, and also this is good for business. And so ultimately, this immigration issue is not only an economic issue, it's a social issue, it's a political issue. And some of the drawbacks are, how do you deal with the new influx of population, and where do you put that population? How does that population fit into the society? And I wanted to talk a little bit about this. I think I wanted to go to a question, and then we'll come in and talk about how they fit in. One of you guys asked a question about how Mexico handles its immigration. And I'd like to show the next clip. And the next clip is the Rush Limbaugh plan for immigration. And so let's roll that clip, and I want you to call in and let me know what you think about what Rush is saying with regards to immigrants coming to this country. So let's walk forward.
The immigration proposals these days, let me add mine to the mix. Call it the Limbaugh laws first. You immigrate to our country, you have to speak the native language. You have to be a professional or an investor. No unskilled workers allowed. Also, there will be no special bilingual programs in the schools in the Limbaugh laws. No special ballots or elections. No government business will be conducted in your language. Foreigners will not have the right to vote or hold political office. If you're in our country, cannot be a burden to taxpayers. You are not entitled to welfare or food stamps or other government goodies. You become, if you invest here, an amount equal to 40,000 times the daily minimum wage. If not stable. But if you want to buy land, you'll be restricted. No waterfront, for instance. As a foreigner, you have to relinquish individual rights to the property. And another thing, you don't have the right to protest. You're allowed no demonstrations, no foreign flag waving, no political organizing, no bad mouthing our president or his policies. You're a foreigner. Shut your mouth or get out. If you come here illegally, you're going to jail. The Limbaugh laws are harsh. Well, every one of the laws I just mentioned are actual laws of Mexico. That's how the Mexican government handles immigrants to their country. If citizens come here illegally and protest in our streets, I'm going to say double standard in Spanish.
Now, regardless of how you feel about Rush Limbaugh, what do you think about what he said? If you were to come to this country, you would have to speak the language. No labor, just professional, and then this causes problems as well. No special programs in your language for your community. You cannot vote. You cannot hold political office. You cannot receive social services for you or your family. You you must invest in the United States. You can't buy land, and you can't protest, and you can't advocate for your rights as an immigrant into the country. John says the forced Mexican repatriation during the 36 directly imposed and in conflict with the acknowledged need for immigrant labor in the agricultural industries. It's true because this is an irrational situation that we're dealing with here. Was this a function of the competition for jobs during the hardships imposed by the Depression? It was, but it was also coupled with this idea I mentioned before, scapegoating. They were actually blaming this immigrant population for the problems that led to the Depression. Now, the Depression was multifaceted. However, this population, it said, we can get rid of this population, then, you know, we can get ourselves back on track as a country. And Judith said, or Julian, I believe, says, it has been a status position if you own the farms, the orchards, etc. I live in an open area and most of the kids work the ranches. And so we'll get into child labor later, but in this country there has always been a tradition of children working. And particularly for immigrants in agriculture, this actually is still going on today. It's not supposed to, but it happens all the time. I've had students in my classes that tell me when they were young how they spent their summers just working with their relatives in the farms around California. So this is still going on. Rosa says, wow, I was about to get angry, and he just shut me up. I didn't know these were the laws of Mexico. And what is really interesting is that there is a little bit of a double standard. And when we talk about this laws, one of the things, though, that I think Rush does not point out is that all of the things and rights he says these people should have are the exact reason that makes us America and the United States of America, because we give people those opportunities. All of the immigrants that came, we translated things into German. That was the first bilingual issue in the country, was German-English. We've allowed people to eventually become part of the society and assimilate and participate. Rhonda says, being a farmer and having our children become farmers or go to school for agriculture is very different from being a farm worker. And it is really true, but our kids don't want to go to school for agriculture either. We had a hard time at the university. We actually designed programs to go into the high schools to teach the kids about where their food comes from and give them the idea that farming is an honorable profession. Farming is something that you would want to do. It's not something that's a last resort. Judith says, I've lived overseas and never once felt that I had country rights to vote, speak up, or be a burden, etc. Rush's ideas are very reasonable. And so it's in a way very difficult to vote, to kind of disagree with him when right across the border on some issues, but this is what makes us not Mexico. We have a caller, and so let's take our first call. This is Nancy from Hollywood. How are you doing, Nancy?
Hi, I'm fine, thank you. And I want to say that work is work. And, of course, every nationality in the world has started somewhere. And so the issue about immigration or any kind of agriculture worker is really not the focal point of the issue. I think the focal point is when people start with any kind of work, if they excel in it, no matter what it may be, I think that the egotistical factor of what happens after that in the mentality of one's mind may subsequently have to do with a lot of social points. find a hub. Well, humble beginnings start in every country, globally speaking. And whatever country excels in labor work is as such. And it's a marvelous thing. And so the respect of that, the respect of that, is another issue. For the people that want to do that kind of work, need to do that kind of work, and love to do that kind of work, okay, appreciated for the fact that they're making some money and not being structured in the system of a handout, and have dignity no matter what you're doing, that's a beautiful thing. And but when we see people on the street, you know, waiting for the bus, getting intoxicated and urinating on our sidewalk, that's another issue. Okay, now if we're going to respect our workers and take them to the field, then we should really give them facilities where they're waiting for the buses on the corners as well. So there's a whole lot of focal points. A lot of issues.
Thanks for calling, Max. You raised a couple of interesting points. Even when we talked about the women in Juarez, what is the obligation of the corporation to facilitate life for these workers? Should there be public restrooms that are available for the migrant workers that are coming in? You're adding issues that add to the layers of this as a social problem. Why people see it as a social problem, because it's not just simply connecting people who walk across the border, walk directly to the farm, pick the fruit, and walk right back and go home. I don't think anybody would have any issues, but it's not that simple. People move in, people begin to interact, people become part of the society, people develop expectations given the nature of that society. And so this is when it becomes contentious. And think about the Rush Limbaugh rules. I mean, if we were to kind of implement these rules, well, one of the issues would be that his complaint is that the immigrants that are coming in are only professionals. And so if you are white-collar workers there and you have immigrants coming in across the border that are now at that job level, that will be the next level of social complaint. So this is the issue that kind of continues to roll as we go along. And I wanted to talk, just take it aside, and talk a little bit about assimilation and what we kind of expect from our workers. And I wanted to start off talking about amalgamation. And amalgamation is generally thought of as, this is the U.S. melting pot. And the diagram for this, if you're math-minded, it would be group A plus group B plus group C equals group D. So when you add all the different cultures together, what you come up with is something else. So when you add Germans and Canadians and Mexicans and Chinese, at the end you come out with something called American. And this is in a way what we expect. Is this how America really, really works, though? What exactly is an American? And when we think about that melting pot, what is it? Is it a salad? Do we all, you know, maintain our individual parts? Or is it a cauldron that as we add more ingredients, eventually will overflow? And so this is a question we kind of ideologically, in the ideal world, expect immigrants to come, kind of blend, and become this thing that we call American. And I think that's what Rush Limbaugh tends to argue all the time. If you're going to be here, you need to become what we are. Well, if you look at America outside of this issue, then what is that? Because because America then is Group A, Group B, Group C. All nine are living out a similar reality, but not exactly the same. There are people who live in Little Italy. There are people who live in Chinatown or Koreatown or place to even areas, and their reality is American, but it's also a little bit different. And who would argue that they can't have that reality? So let's go to this other idea of cultural pluralism. And I wanted to talk about cultural pluralism, and the chart that you see behind me is what California looks like in terms of the big racial division. So you have Hispanic and white, which are the two largest columns, then Asian and then African American. And this was 2000 statistics. So Hispanics, about 40%, white, well, whoever makes up that group, same with Hispanics, 39.9%, Asian, 11.3%, and African American, 7.6% of the population. So when we talk about LA, what we see out here is cultural pluralism. Because what we see are groups of cultures living together simultaneously. They all have not become one thing. And the diagram or the equation for this would be Group A, Group B, Group C, equals Group A, Group B, plus Group C. So you add everything together, and on the other side, the groups don't maintain their integrity. And what is interesting about this is that this is actually the new discussed form of assimilation. This is what is going on in the society. People are coming in and still maintaining their identity from their place of origin. And is this a problem? Does this mean that they're not becoming American? And what I wanted to show you, and I wanted these to come on full screen, and so we can kind of talk about it, is the population change in LA over the last few years.
And so when we look at the, I'm going to try to use this pointer here. When we look at the different groups, I want you to pay specific attention to the different colors and how the map begins to change. So when we look at the map now, we see in one area, we have majority black right on the pointer, and then we have majority other. And for the most part, in the 1940s, we're talking about majority Anglo as a California population. And so let's go to the next. When we go to the next slide, this is very subtle in the 1950s. We actually see the black population increasing in different areas. This is around downtown and also around Watts. But downtown and also around Watts. And look, what we still see is the dominant majority. And let's go to the next slide. As we move to the next slide, what we begin to see is the population is beginning to change a little bit. And so the Anglo population is going down, and these new colors that we're seeing where the pointer is the rise of the Hispanic population. And so what we're seeing is a total change, and actually on my screen I'm seeing a little different colors than you guys. So when you pull up these maps, I'll post them online, you can really take a look at the detail. Let's look at 1970. As we go through 1970, what we're seeing is we add a new group, Asian Pacific Islanders, which is this new kind of orangey-looking group. Then we're talking about the Hispanic majority, and this is actually beginning to get larger and larger, and the African American community is kind of joining. So the downtown and the Watts area and Taunton are coming together. Next slide. As we move to 1980, and these are pretty dramatic. Think about the changes in populations in just 10 years. So we're talking about in a decade, you have pretty much a changeover population. So as the dominant culture goes down, and you see that this culture, the Anglo majority, is kind of being displaced a little bit in LA. And what we see is a rise of the Hispanic minority that's built in 1990. As we go to 1990, you kind of see how this is increasing more. Where we see this color here, where the pointer is, this is no majority. So these are the places where people are pretty much intermingling and intermarrying. And then let's go to 2000. If you go to 2000 and then you look at Los Angeles based on this map, this is very much a pluralistic society. And what you can see is this large increase of the Hispanic population. And in LA, we're talking mostly Mexicans. And so this is why the focus here is on this particular population. All right, let's come off of these maps and let's think about what we see. Over the course of several decades, you actually see a population shift in the community. And in sociology, we talk about this because none of this can happen without consequences for the larger society. So as you look at the colors on those maps, ask yourself, how has this increase in populations altered the social relationships? You're now living near or working near people who have maybe a different culture or ethnic group than you, a lot more than you. I don't mean a lot more than you, but a large population. You are now having to deal with this issue of increased immigrants in terms of schools. You also have to deal with this issue in terms of competition for jobs, competition for houses, competition for resources. And so when we look at this change and the change in diversity, this is why we're having this argument over labor. Because how do you absorb this amount of people and how do you fit them into the current working system? Whereas in LA, African Americans tended to occupy those what would be considered lower status positions, not necessarily ag per se. Now there's another group that has come in and moved into that particular position. So as the groups come in, everyone is shifted. And looking at the change in LA, you can see why people are having issues. It's occurring very rapidly, and people are having to cope with these differences in society. So when we talk about this, we're now talking about this issue of assimilation. When you go back and look at those maps and you see those colors, are all of those people becoming American? And assimilation, when you think about the Borg, you all kind of have a similar idea of reality. You all have similar goals. You're all working towards the same thing. You see yourself as the same people. Well, that's not what's happening. And assimilation would be group A, group B, group C, all added together equals group A. So everybody becomes whatever the dominant group is. But that is not what's going on in LA. And so this is why we're having this issue. It's not really, I think like Nancy said, the issue of people doing the farm work, is all of the other social issues that are attached to that. How are these populations being absorbed into the society? And so I wanted to kind of wrap that up because people, you know, you ask yourself, well, is immigration just good or immigration just bad? Is immigration good for the labor market or bad? And the reality is it's both. It's good and bad in the society as well as in the labor market. You have to figure out how the society adjusts to adapt to the new population, particularly if it's changing really quickly. And so what I want to do now is actually shift gears a little bit. If you have any other comments on immigration, feel free to still call in. We can still talk about it. And we will come back a little bit to the end. But I want to talk about organizations. And this relates to the book I had you read for today, The McDonaldization of Society. And I think this is a book that one should read, regardless of if you are in school or a student or whatever, because it kind of gives you an idea of where we're going in terms of how we organize labor and how work is organized in society. And let's talk about where this idea comes from. Industrialization emerged out of the work of Max Weber in the late 1800s, early 1900s. And Weber was looking at how society was changing from the feudal system based on kings and lords and knights to this new industrial reality where we had laws and policies. And basically, talked about the modern society was becoming a little bit more rational. He talks about this process of rationalization. And what this is a process whereby traditional modes of thinking were being replaced by what is called ends means analysis, concerned with efficiency, formalized control, whereas in the past, work was at the whim of the king. As we become more industrialized, work is related to the corporation, work is related to the laws. It's not the one on high kind of talking to everyone and giving them their working orders. Ron says, I think we're going back to immigration. I really have no problem with having a balance between the country that people are coming from and what we can expect from their government in their country of origin. I think that we should have regulations that match. And this is going back to this idea of the Limbaugh laws. If we have regulations that match Mexico, then we are going to experience labor shortages in this country. If we don't allow people who want to come in, that are laborers to come in, then we are not going to have fresh fruit in the winter. And so when we think about this, this is, you know, something that we have to consider. All right, going on with Weber. And Weber talked about bureaucracy. And what he said was, basically, bureaucracy is kind of like the logical outcome of this new rationalized society. And everything is formalized, everything is structured, everything is ordered based on systematic rules and principles. And what is interesting is he saw bureaucratization as actually positive because it was getting away from the king and the lords dictating the reality of work. He said this was actually a way to make work more, I don't want to say fair, but more efficient. And it was a way to kind of get rid of having to deal with the charismatic traditional leader. It wasn't going to be the king who set the policies. It was now going to be organized so we could make the most profit, be the most efficient. And he gave a couple of characteristics of bureaucracy. And the first thing he says is that there's a high degree of division of labor. And so when you think of a bureaucratic organization, you can think of a university. What you have is everyone has a specific task. Everyone is required to do their job. So let's just say the university. You have the person who does registration, then you have the person who does financial aid, then you have the person who does courses or overrides, and each of those tasks is separate and individual, and the person who does your registration has no idea what is going on in terms of your financial aid. Even though, as people, they're related to us in terms of the bureaucratic organization, these are separate and individual issues that they want everyone to deal with. The next one is after that, a hierarchy of authority. And instead of the king at the top, you may now have the shareholders or the board of directors fine. Everyone answers to someone else. So as a professor, I have the chair. The chair has the person who is over our college. That person answers to the provost, answers to the president. And so there is now this structure that organizes our lives and organizes our work. And remember, Abraham, he saw this as being a positive because it was getting away from the irrational nature of the monarchy and that type of rule. The next one is rules and regulations. For Weber, he saw the emergence of rules and regulations as a way to make the organization of our society much more efficient. And we don't even have to talk in detail. Everywhere you go, there are detailed, specific rules and regulations. If you are a student, you get a huge book that gives you the rules and regulations and who you talk to in any university. The next one is impersonal relationships. And when you think about impersonal relationships, what is really interesting is who do you talk to that really understands your problem? I remember being a student and dealing with the university as an organization. And I remember if you had a financial aid problem, there wasn't one person who knew you. There wasn't one person who, if you came in on Tuesday and told your story, I lost my job, my check is late, I'm having all these problems, I need some help. Well, if you went back next week, you probably were talking to a different person. So if you think about the image behind me in terms of organization, it's very, very impersonal. You become a number, and you deal with multiple people whose only task is to do that one particular thing. And so for Weber, this is leading towards efficiency. However, it's also problematic. And part of the reason it's problematic is that you begin to become very, very impersonal. The relationships, no one in the financial aid office knew me really by name or anything about me, even though as a student, every semester I went and told them my whole life story in a way. Weber talks about career ladders. He says where advancement itself in a position or an occupation becomes a career. So think about all these people behind me as well as yourself. When you go to work, you are going to work not just to get money, not necessarily because you love what you're doing, but part of what you would like is also to move up, to become one of those higher level decision makers. And so the career itself becomes your goal. Weber said this is an outcome of this rationalized society and this bureaucratic society. And then finally, he talks about a high degree of efficiency. And this is the coordination of activities. And what is interesting is that when we think about this, it is really true. I mean, when you think about how a university functions, I went to a large university that had 35,000 students, and every year it kind of worked out. We got all 35,000 people in classes at the right time, even though some of us had financial aid issues, whatever it may be, it seemed to work out. And so he was saying, you know, there is a lot of coordination. This becomes very efficient. How will we be able to run a university without a bureaucracy? And so this issue is kind of setting the stage for what Princeton picks up on later in our society. Before we go to break, I want to add another idea of this bureaucracy. Writing in the 60s, Stigmund said, well, not only does what Weber says happens, this specialization, division of labor, hierarchy of authority, rules, etc., but Stigmund says you also now have to introduce an administrative administrator's system of files. And a couple minutes ago, you saw this file enter. Think about the filing system that exists in most corporate structures. There is a manila envelope for almost everything. And so once you institute the system of files, this is a way of kind of getting yourself down to this organizational structure, I know where everything is, everything has a place. And what Sergio says is also important is as the organization grows, society itself or the organization itself becomes more diversified and the products become more diversified. So whereas the universities in the past, you can learn history, English, science. Now you can study foreign languages, you can study anything, you can come out and be a chef. And so the products of the university are becoming much, much more diversified than they were. And finally, Stichon says something that's really important. When you look at this growth of bureaucracy, there is also a separation of ownership from day-to-day duties. So whereas in the past, the owners came actually to the job, they actually did a little bit of the work, they were actually involved in the day-to-day running of the job. When you think about Sam Walton, when he started Walmart, basically he went out in his car with products in the back of his truck, and he did the selling. When the stores opened, he was in those stores pushing materials. But as Walmart grew, as it developed, they got a board of directors, and eventually he was no longer involved in the day-to-day activities of that organization. And Stichholm says, not only are the things Weber mentioned important, but this aspect is really, really important. And I wanted to point to this particular point, because I think that is what is also important in terms of internalization. So the owner, the person who is actually going to reap the profits from that job, they are not actually involved in the day-to-day workings of that job. And let me just take it aside and say this in the context of our current economic crisis. And one of the things that is the debate now is, should the shareholders, should those bigwigs at the top be given a bailout? And what I find very interesting is that, you know, half of the people, and most of the people in this instance, are actually saying, no, these people are the people who got us into trouble. But when you think about it, the reason that this can happen and the reason we can be in the economic situation we're in is because the owners of those corporations, the people who benefit from those corporations, have really no involvement in the day-to-day reality of the lives of the people who work there or how those people's lives are manifested in the rest of society. So if I'm a shareholder, my job basically is to just make sure that me and my other shareholders collect a profit. We are not interested in whether you have your pension. We are not interested in whether you are actually making a wage that you can eat off of or live from. And so this is how we got into the trouble. This is my interpretation of where part of the problem is because people that are reaping the benefits have no idea of the day-to-day realities of those corporations. And so, I don't see how long the next clip is. I think let's go to clip 3, and this is basically just a discussion of bureaucracy. I'm stations, gave the number, the government down to the DMV. And every individual thing you have to do, you have to go to a different person to get it done. So there's not one person who can holistically take you from registration all the way to the end. And this is the issue, and this is one of the things that Weber was beginning to worry about. As he talked about rationalization, he begins to talk about some of the problems that can arise. One is alienation. When you go to work in a bureaucracy, do you really care about what you're doing? You are a numbers cruncher. You're going to do your time from 8 to 5, and you're going to leave. You have nothing really invested in the job that you're doing. And so this is one real serious problem with bureaucracy. I was a social worker for a lot of years, and I actually saw this in the social work field. You had clients, and even though these clients were people, and even though they had real individual problems, there were times when we were actually expected to kind of treat them like a collective. So all alcoholics had to be sent here, even though there were multiple reasons for their alcoholism. And so when you encountered other social workers, they were very, very disconnected from what they did. Well, you know, today I just have to go and take these many people to Alcoholics Anonymous, and then I'm done. So there was nothing really invested in the work that they were doing. They were also says that one of the problems that can arise with bureaucracy is ritualism. And where everyone is just simply going through the motions, even though there may be a problem. I am sure that all of us could sit down and design a better structure for the DMV. Because once you go through, if there is one thing wrong on a form, you have to go through the entire process again. They can't just fix the one thing. And this is really, really a characteristic of a lot of bureaucracies. So you find yourself over and over having to go through the same process. And the last thing, and this is what I think is really related to McDonaldization, is this idea that there is no accountability. There are so many people in this bureaucracy who is responsible. Think about the Exxon Valdez oil spill. And think about the train crash that recently happened in L.A. One of the things that we always try to find out is who is ultimately responsible. But what happens when corporations like Exxon destroy a community because of an oil spill? Is it that one person? Is it the captain? Or is it the structure of that organization that doesn't invest the money in different types of boats that could secure the oil, et cetera, et cetera? So there are a lot of questions that arise in terms of who is responsible. You ever had a problem going through registering? And you have to go back and figure out, where do I go? Where is the start of this problem? Because you have to go back to that person, and that person ultimately is going to tell you, well, you probably need to go see the person in cubicle B to get this work done first, then you need to come see me. And so everybody can kind of pass the buck to the next person in the organization. What I want to do now is I want to take a break, and when we come back, we'll spend the rest of the class talking about the McDonaldization of society. And I want you to write in and let me know, did you like the book? Did you agree with the book? And I know that you all have different versions, but were there different points that struck any of you as being particularly true? Do you think Ritzer is an alarmist? And have you experienced McDonaldization yourselves? So let's take a short break, and then we'll come back and really pick up our discussion. Actually, before we take a break, it looks like we have a caller. So let's take a call, and then we'll go to break. This is Rita from Sunland. Hi, Rita. How are you?
Hi. Pretty good, thank you. I think what needs to happen in a bureaucracy or any system is like a shared interest in getting the thing to work. And this is what we're lacking when we import poverty, you know, ignorance and arrogance with the illegal immigrants. Now, our banks, like, gave them loans, and then they, at the bottom, didn't want to pay their mortgages, and so the system collapsed. Actually, whatever the boys on Wall Street did, as corrupt as it was, you know, splintering everyone's loans and selling them on to this person, that person, still, if the people had just paid their mortgage, we wouldn't be in this situation. But no, you know, they don't really have a vested interest in this country or being an American or really being a part of our American way of life.
Okay.
I have a problem with that. I have a really big problem with that.
So are you linking the current economic crisis directly to immigrants coming to this country? Are you still there? Call back me because I'd like to continue that conversation. The question I asked, and some of you can respond, she said it's the people coming in and not paying their mortgages. All right, are you back, Rita?
Yes.
Okay, are you linking the current economic crisis to the immigrants that are coming to this country?
Directly, yes.
Okay, why? Why are you making that link?
Because it's pretty obvious that they don't assimilate, they don't pay their bills, and yet fools like George Bush say, oh, hey, there's not enough Hispanics to have their own houses. Oh, you know, you see, you can't be compassionate when you are trying to run a country, unfortunately. You can't just go, okay, we got to redistribute the wealth and all that, because that's communism, and this is why it's biting us in the butt now, because, oh, well, everyone has, you know, the right to own a home. Well, no, it's not true, and it makes me feel like a real fool who bought my own house and paid it off myself. Oh, no, we're going to bail out these people, you know, no, oh, no, we're going to give them another loan now, you know, and all this kind of crap, and it's ridiculous, and it really eats away at our society, and it makes us very cynical about the government as well as the people coming here. You say that, well, we won't get fruit in the wintertime. I'd rather not have fruit than find diapers in the middle of my street that the Indians toss out of their cars all the time. They don't care about the upkeep of this country, and they don't care about being an American. They just trash it.
Okay, I want you guys to come call in and respond to Rita, but I also want to make a point. I have done over the summer a little bit of dabbling in real estate, and one of the things that I printed out, and next time if I remember, I will bring a copy of a foreclosure list. I'll just make a random community. And actually, and you can't really tell, I'm going to make a big generalization here, but the names on that foreclosure list are Smith and Jones and standard American quote names. It's not Rosales and Gonzalez, and it's not full of Changs, and, you know, I'm really generalizing here, but I think this is one of the issues. We're kind of linking things together, and I think, Rita, if you think about it, part of the problem is that the average American is in a crisis with their mortgage. It is not necessarily that. It is the immigrants that are coming in that are in a crisis. It's the average American that has the SUV, the 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 credit cards, that wanted the bigger house because this is what we do. We aspire to this new status. And I can understand your anger because you perceive your society as being in essence trash. However, we need to kind of separate out these issues because when you look at the foreclosure list, when you look at what's going on, that is not specifically an immigrant issue. That is actually everyday, average, middle-class Americans that we're trying to keep up with the Joneses. And so this is where we get into the confusion because we begin to link social problems together. And even though there is an immigrant issue, and I would argue there are some immigrants that come that don't care, that don't want to assimilate, but all the research that I've seen suggests that the majority of people do want to become normalized, as the word I'm going to use, American citizens, and they're not out to kind of destroy the country. They'd like to walk on their gold paved streets to aspire to have all of those things that make us unique as America, the house, the picket fence, and all that. Let's take a break. I want you to think about what we have said. I want you to gather up your opinions and call in, and we will continue to have this discussion. So let's go to break, and we'll be right back.
You are watching VHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Bill DeLuca, professor of theater arts at Cal State Dominguez. I'd like to invite you to come and see our next production, Ilia Cristina, by Luis Alfaro. This is a production that is based on a Greek tragedy collection by Sophocles. It tells an unusual tale, a tragical play, about a woman's revenge against her mother, killed her father. And Alfaro sets it in East LA, so it becomes something of a barrio tragedy. And Ilia Cristina is named that way because she is a very passionate person. He is out to revenge herself. Alfaro uses a lot of humor as well. It's a very entertaining play, so hopefully you'll come see us in October for the opening of Ilia Cristina.
Hi, my name is Heather McGrory, and I'm coming to Dominguez Hills from Sacramento. My major is clinical science, and I chose this school specifically because they offer this major. I know, like most about Dominguez Hills, it's the small class sizes and the ability to live on campus and be so close.
On this job, safety is our first concern. We have a lot that could go wrong. Unfortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Local Edition. I'm your host, Ben McKay, and our guest, President of Cal State Dominguez Hills, Dr. Mildred Garcia. Dr. Garcia, welcome to Local Edition.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the invitation.
You just celebrated your one-year anniversary as President of Cal State Dominguez Hills. Tell us about how it was.
It's been an absolutely wonderful year. Coming here to California, everybody has been so welcoming. And, of course, California State University Dominguez Hills is a great institution. And so they've embraced me, and we're doing wonderful things.
Tell us about your background. You grew up in New York City.
Brooklyn, New York. I'm a first-generation college student, which means that I'm the first in my family to go to college and get a college degree. I'm one of seven, and unfortunately, my father died when I was 12, and my mom worked in a factory, but she always said to me, and my parents always said to me, that the only inheritance a poor family could leave you is a good education, and I've remembered that all my life.
Well, give you that positive inner attitude that you can go through. You didn't just get your college degree, you went on and got your PhD.
I did. Wonderful at Columbia University Teachers College in Manhattan.
What attracted you to Cal State Dominguez Hills?
You know, I was a president on the East Coast already, and I was called by many, many friends. California State University Dominguez Hills is stated as the most diverse university west of the Mississippi.
People from all walks of life.
No one single group in the majority. And I wanted to work in a place that reminded me of what helped me be who I am today and give back to that community. And here I am with students from all walks of life, part of L.A., South Bay, helping people reach their dreams.
As I said, you got your PhD, but what inspired you as a young girl once you started a college? I think you went to a community college first.
I did.
And you went to a four-year university, graduated from NYU.
Right.
And then what inspired you to keep going with your education?
You know, it was the good faculty members. That's why California State University, Dominguez Hills, and my other sister institutions are the institutions that are the answer to California. They inspired me. It was the faculty, it was the classroom, it was the one-on-one to tell me and give me that inspiration that I could do it. Because I didn't have anybody at home that I could speak to about what does it mean to go to college. As a matter of fact, I would come back to my neighborhood and we would talk about people going to college. We always thought that was privileged people, that I would never have a chance. But it was faculty members that inspired me, just like the faculty at California State University to make a film.
Hello, my name is Kayla Yellen Hirsch, and I'm a professor in the art department at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And I and my students started a project in January in liaison with the Los Angeles Center. And we're doing two sets of murals, one for the OBGYN Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, and the other is for the Pediatrics Needs Department. One of the great things about it is that you know, to improve the atmosphere of a inner city hospital by providing images that are both educational and fun. And also, the other important thing is the collaborative project between artists who have different styles and are able to integrate the styles into cohesive images that work very well together. We hope that these two murals will bring joy and educational material to an inner city hospital.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay One Stops are here to help you grow.
I found out about the One Stop representative in my store and presented the services that they provide.
As is, we've opened over 4,000 applicants, coming in at 125 jobs, and One Stop really helped us find the true gems and out of all these people.
On the business side, One Stop provides training, it provides a resource for contacts, also provides a resource for training to be able to take someone there that should train and use the facility because we offer new classes of areas of the data.
It was just a great experience. The members of the One Stop were always helpful in understanding
the services designed to help your business succeed. The South Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 310-970-7799 or visit our website at southbayresource.net.
The One Stop is your resource for business in the South Bay.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark. Nice paper.
Enrich your life. Increase your learning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Finally, call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Thank you.
And welcome back to the Sociology of Work. I'm Dr. Squires. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program that is available. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we're broadcasting three classes, Communications 300, Organizational Communications on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m., Sociology 315, the Sociology of Work, on Saturdays from noon to 2 p.m., and Labor Law 412, Labor 412 on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you can earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years and then started over. If you would like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. Welcome back to class, and we left on a really, really good call. Rita called, and she made this link between the current economic crisis that we're having and immigration that we were just talking about. And I would propose another theory. I would actually suggest that the housing and economic crisis that we're experiencing is much more linked to the McDonaldization of our society than it is to the immigration in our society. So let's look at what McDonaldization is, and you guys can call in and tell me, will you agree with Rita, her perspective, or the perspective I'm going to kind of throw out there. This idea comes from George Ritzer, and I am using this particular book. I have all of the different ones you have, but I bought in this one because this one is actually a reader. And they give you examples of McDonaldization, how it spreads in society as well as other ways our society is becoming McDonaldized. And Ritzer is a professor at the University of Maryland. And very well written, he writes on globalization, consumption, classical and postmodern social theory. So he's looking at large-scale ideas of what is going on in the social world. And basically, he argues, and this is his definition of McDonaldization. McDonaldization is the process by which the principles of the fast food restaurant are coming to dominate more and more the sectors of American society as well as the rest of the world. And in all of the books that you've read, this is the definition of McDonaldization. So this idea of how McDonald's runs, how it's organized, the structure of that organization is now becoming part of our daily lives. And let's take a look at our next clip, and this is Ritzer actually talking about McDonaldization and his ideas.
During the 19th century, sociologist Max Weber developed the rationality principle, which is the acceptance of rules, efficiency, and practical results as an important aspect of formal organizations and bureaucracies. At the end of the 20th century, sociologist George Ritzer found a new model for the rationality principle, the Golden Arches.
Weber argued that the bureaucracy was the model of the rationalization process, But it seemed to me when I thought about rationalization at the end of the 20th century that really the fast food restaurant was a better model for his process, and so that led me to focus on McDonald's and McDonaldization. McDonaldization is defined as the process by which the principles that supply at the base of the fast food restaurant are coming to dominate more and more sectors of society and more parts of the world. There are four basic principles of McDonaldization. The first is efficiency, which means that you look for the best route to whatever goal it is that you have in mind. The second is predictability, that things are the same from one time to another time or one place to another place. The third is calculability, or an emphasis on quantity rather than quality. And the fourth is an emphasis on non-human technology rather than human technology. And so what we see is taking the skills away from people and building them into these technologies.
These principles have extended into other segments of our lives. Exercise, shopping, video rentals, reading, education, and even church services have all been modified to fit our McDonaldized society.
Colonization would not have spread throughout society and throughout the world if it did not have a variety of positive consequences. We want some efficiency. We want some predictability. It's just that when those become so predominant that they drive everything else out, that everything becomes predictable. So I'm arguing that we shouldn't have any colonization. It's just I think what we've seen in the last 50 years or so is colonization gone wild.
Okay, let's continue. Now, what Ritzer is talking about, and we're having a little bit of technical difficulties in the studio, so you may hear a little bit of noise in the background. He's talking about what's happened to our particular society. And basically, think about what he's saying. Think about what you've read. This idea of efficiency and all of that is basically kind of being spread out into how we conduct our day-to-day business. And think about what he says. Efficiency, he has four main dimensions, and these are the ones I pulled out for your pop quiz. The optimum method of completing a task. And this is basically with the least amount of cost and the least amount of effort. So what we find in companies and corporations is that everything is done to maximize the efficiency of that task in our McDonaldized world. And a lot of times, though, we actually find that we have more problems as we come. Think about something like voicemail. And voicemail was set up to be very, very efficient. And now we end up probably spending a lot more time on a phone call because we simply can't talk to a person and ask them a question. And so for Ritzer, if you think about this, what is the most efficient way to get hamburgers made? All uniform beef patties, you put them on, they roll on, when they're done, they fall off. And it doesn't matter if this is the best way to cook them, it is the most efficient way to sell them and to make a profit. So let's take a look at our next clip. And when this talks about kind of how we're moving forward in our society, and I'll come back to it.
Grab a bucket and mop from the bottom and hop. There is nothing so clean as my burger machine. Bring the broom and a brush. Clean it up for the rush. Before you open the door, what a shine on the floor. When we made up our bed, start all over again. Tell me what will it be at McDonald's and Spain. Today.
Apple's commercials, they stress the cleanliness, the efficiency, how quickly you can get your food. And think about this. I often ask students to think about this. How long do you wait in a fast food restaurant or actually a fast food drive-thru before you get angry? Is it now 5 minutes? If you're in that drive-thru line, 5 minutes. Are you in that line too long? Because we expect that food to come out in seconds, and from the moment you pay, and remember, separating the window where you pay from the window where you pick up the food is also efficient as well. You expect that food to be ready in the few seconds that it takes to get from payment to pick up window. James says, on McDonaldization, I like the book, the thought there was a broader social network involved, and felt that Gritzer could have delved deeper into issues ailing our current society based on the need to get more or less from work. And I think that's a really good point, James. He says they have changed the name from McDonaldization to Six Sigma. Currently, my company is spending a lot of energy on defining roles, trying to understand how we can measure success. I hate the idea and process involved. What is interesting is that a lot of companies are actually doing this consciously. How, and they're not saying, okay, we're going to McDonaldize our companies, even though some are. And if you have the reader, they talk about the different corporations that are trying to be like McDonald's, McToys, you know, McStarbucks, et cetera, et cetera. But basically, think of those commercials. It was all about being quick and efficient. You get a break and you get it fast. We have another comment from Judith. After reading the Ritzer book, I know why I have resisted McDonald's and even Starbucks. I still appreciate the human side of business. And let's now put this in the context of the current economic society and how people filled out mortgages, how all those things were done up to now. It was about, and you bought a home, you've seen the paperwork, you know what the process is. It's a detailed, step-by-step, minute line of detail that you have to go through in the homeowner's process. And what happened, I think, recently is people got pushed through that process without actually stopping and looking at whether individual families could actually afford that home. The mortgage business, the real estate business was very efficient, but did it actually relate to the people well that it was dealing with? And the answer is clearly no, or not, we wouldn't be in this situation. So even the early commercials, and I want to say this, we'll talk about McDonald's, but we're not picking on McDonald's. And Ritzer makes a point to note that this is not specifically McDonald's. It has to do with the process of how this organization is put together and ultimately what that means for the rest of our lives. All right, the next point, according to Ritzer, is calculability. And these are the assessments of outcomes based on quantifiable rather than subjective criteria. So basically, what does that mean? We are concerned more with quantity rather than quality. And so one of the points he makes is the reason we have a Big Mac instead of a Healthy Mac is because we want to make sure we're getting a big value for our money. And what is really interesting about this particular issue is when we think about it, and we think about the whole supersize phase that we went through, and this supersize phase came even in the context of diabetes, obesity, etc., people still wanted to feel as if they were getting more for their money. And so the corporations played up to that, and McDonald's played up to that. You weren't getting better fries, you were getting more fries. And as Americans, we all felt good about that. We're critiquing it, but the reality is that we all participate in this, and we actually still do participate in it. So we're worried more about the quantity of what we're getting. The corporations are interested in moving it out fast, getting it out where the numbers are high, but not necessarily where the products are good. And this is one of the problems with the finalization. The next thing he talks about is predictability. And predictability is a production process organized to guarantee uniformity of the product and standardized outcomes. Generally, wherever you go in America, the Big Macs are the same. And generally worldwide, there's a little bit of differences in some countries, but generally a Big Mac is a Big Mac is a Big Mac. And we expect that. We wanted to have this right super secret sauce, etc., etc. And one of the things we can think about is how is this looking in the rest of our society? All shopping malls are looking the same. All toy stores, all bookstores, all, as a matter of fact, all grocery stores, everything we interact with is beginning to kind of have a leveling of the structure. So most universities function exactly the same way. And you'll often hear about the universities that are outside of the box. For example, some ones that don't use grades. But in general, everybody's kind of homogenized a little bit. And there's something good about this because we want to know what to expect. Whenever you go to a DoubleTree, you can kind of have an idea of what the rooms are going to look like. But this problem leaves no room for individuality. It leaves no room for creativity. And even the creativity is built into the predictability, if that's even possible. So when we're thinking about it, is this true? Do you think society is really working like this? One of the things that Ritzer also talks about is this idea of control. And this is substituting more predictable non-human labor for human labor. And a good example is the Strive machine. And he talks about that. The Strive machine is set up to make French fries exactly the same way every time. You pour the bag in, you pop them down, and it pops up exactly right. Human beings used to burn French fries. Well, now we're able to control the human behavior. And we can do it with machines, and so therefore we can make sure that our French fries are cut by a machine, pretty much their standard size, and we don't have to worry anymore about human error. Well, I want us to look at our next clip because how is this idea of control going to impact you in terms of your work? So let's roll the next clip.
Defector tools are used for performing work on parts. There are a multitude of tools used in conjunction with industrial robots, with the primary types including welding guns, paint spray nozzles, and various machining tools. Welding guns mounted on the wrist of a robot offer numerous advantages over manually held welding guns or welding with fixed automation. These advantages include increased welding speed and relief from the harsh welding environment for the human welder. Robotic welding can provide dexterity, consistency, and flexibility to an operation while typically improving weld quality and ultimately end product quality. Robots are used extensively for both part welding and spot welding operations, and are an integral part of most high-production, high-quality welding installations, including automotive assembly lines and furniture and appliance manufacturing.
All right, think about this idea of replacing humans with technology. It sounds really, really good when we can, you know, find like a Roomba vacuum to vacuum our floor. But ultimately, what are the social consequences of this? First of all, who was missing from that clip? It was really short, but there were no people. If there were no people, that means there were no jobs, there was no income, there was no money for a family that were a human being used to do that job. You can get faster work. We cannot require human beings to work as long as we need them to, but you can require robots to do that. Very beneficial for the company. Once again, what is going to happen to the human worker? But listen to what's most important. There's no labor laws. You don't have to deal with raises. You don't have to deal with health care, maternity leave, retirement benefits, none of the things that are specific to human beings doing labor for another. And so this idea of McDonaldization is not that our society is just becoming predictable. It's not that we're interested in the quantity over quality, but it also relates to the fact that we are actually, in essence, sometimes to get those other things, moving people out. And many people have been replaced by machines. I'm sure that the next step in education is going to be totally the electronic teacher, where everything is a computer. You just program a question and the computer will search Google for you and give you an answer. But is this the actual same thing as having interaction and learning from someone? Dawn says, in reading the book, I recall a trip to Hawaii with a friend who had never been there before. He was scared to try a vast array of local foods and opted for the safety of rationalized safe place that he knew well, which was McDonald's. Yes, I am. And then he says, would you see this as conditioning? Yes, I would see this as conditioning. Our kids are conditioned to, we see McDonald's as normal, regular food. And as a matter of fact, it is actually spreading all over the world. I read where kids can identify Ronald McDonald's 90% of the time. He is the most recognizable character next to Santa Claus. And so when you think about it, we are all becoming conditioned to kind of expect the service, expect the food, expect the structure, everything of McDonald's, and we're teaching it to our kids. Marsha says, certain things we do want to know what to expect. However, I'm missing the uniqueness of different grocery stores and retail stores, she says, specific to a region when they've traveled to different parts of the country. Absolutely. When you're traveling now, all the Rite Aids are exactly the same. They may have a section now for L.A. Rite Aid that has I love L.A. stuff there or I love New Jersey stuff, but everything is exactly the same. There is no uniqueness anymore in products and services. And what is really interesting is that when you think about how much control the corporations then actually have over what you buy, not just how you work, but what you buy. I lived in a little town in northern Missouri, and there was one Walmart, and I'll talk about Walmart later, but came in, all the rest of the stores closed down, and the thing about this Walmart, and it was pretty much the biggest thing in the entire little town, was the Walmart. They didn't sell birth control, and they didn't sell birth control because belief of the corporation or whoever was in charge of that particular aspect, they didn't believe in birth control. And I thought this was interesting when we talked to the class because this was the major place that you would go to get most of your products. And here it was, the corporation had control over what you purchased. So not only what the people were doing, but all that calculability, predictability, this is what was going on in that particular organization. So how is work replacing people in this McDonaldized society? When I travel, you want to find something unique, but often, and this is not because we're ugly Americans, this has to do with how we're socialized to feel comfortable with the things in our particular society. You look for things that you feel familiar, that feels familiar to you, you're comfortable with. All right, let's move on. One of the things that Bridget says, and this this is really, really interesting. Once we think about, okay, we're being replaced by robots, so this is impacting our job, we are now moving to the point where the corporations are controlling a good deal of how we live our lives, what we do, etc. He said there's a rationality to this McDonaldization, a side effect of the over-rationalized system. This is interesting because the workers are trained to perform a single, highly routinized task. Well, think about it. You briefly mentioned what happens when that task can not only be performed by a robot, but can also be performed much cheaper by someone else in another country. And so even though it is not necessarily in the best interest of the corporations to, you know, completely wipe out all the other businesses in the world, this is going on. Is it a form of our culture, education? Is rationalization a reflection of our mind, our society, and our desires to have more or less? I think Faber would say it is in towards our movement, towards a more structured society. It's towards a more rational legal society where supposedly this is leveling the playing field. Everybody has to follow the same rules, but those rules benefit businesses sometimes in a very, very different way than they benefit workers. So yes, it is part of our culture, it's part of our education, it's part of our norms and what we expect. Another aspect, and if you think about this rationality, when you go and you do the same thing day in and day out, day in and day out, you also experience a kind of worker burnout. And for the corporations, that is not very efficient. And so if they can move to find someone else who can do that or something else to do it, it's much more beneficial. But for you as a worker, you just have to adjust yourself to this planned routine task over and over. Another thing that Richard says is an outcome of this is de-skilling. And de-skilling is getting a workforce with the minimal abilities as possible just to complete simple, focused tasks. And this means that they can be trained cheaply and quickly, and one worker isn't interchangeable with another worker. Think about mechanics. Let's just pick a blue-collar work. Mechanics were highly trained to work on all parts of your car. They could pull down the engine and take apart your carburetor, your air filter, etc. Well, as we move to more computer-based technology in the cars, your average corner mechanic is no longer able to fix those cars. As a matter of fact, some of the things have been turned into modules, and so whereas you can break down the entire carburetor down to the last screw or whatever's in it, now you have the carburetor module that you have to send all the way back to the factory to purchase just another module from the factory. So that mechanic is no longer skilled in the nuances of the entire car. So now you may go someplace just to get your air conditioner fixed, just to get your carburetor fixed. And that is the only skill those people are able to do. And they can be trained quickly, and you can easily find someone else that can replace the module, the carburetor module, or whatever it is in your car. So if you think about this, think about how it's spreading across the whole society, not just from the restaurants, but into the rest of our culture. Another thing, and until I read this book, I really never thought about it. Webster talks about consumer workers. And now organizations have come to a point where we actually do some of the work that the corporation or the organization of workers used to do for us. A good example is bussing your own table. When you went to a restaurant, part of the restaurant experience was not having to cook, but also not having to clear the dishes and wash the dishes. Well, now, in many restaurants, you get a tray, you pick up your tray, you are now responsible for busting your own tables. When you go to the grocery store, you are now responsible for bagging your own groceries. So as we become more efficient, the corporations are turning over tasks that they used to do to us. It's much cheaper to have each of us bag our own groceries than to hire bag boys that they used to have. Lauren says, oh, she's talking about where they live in North Carolina, one of the police that we made. So we're now consumer workers, we're now de-skilled, and so as you can see, this is really pervasive. And we're going to run out of time today, but I want you to think about McDonald's, and we're not picking on McDonald's. And Richard says, you know, he can talk about the Starbuckization of society, but what this has to do with work is how we are all, in a way, being channeled into a very mundane, routine work reality. And everything is set up to be efficient for the system, not efficient for the consumers necessarily, not efficient for the workers, not efficient for the people who are going to be engaged in those goods and services. And McDonald's, when it started, this was a good idea. And I want all of you to think about this. We all want the McDonald's dream, the Walmart dream. You start with a small business out of the back of your car, and you build it up, and you build it up, and next thing you know, you're running a large-scale multinational corporation. That is one of the American dreams, in a way, to become business and financially successful. But how is this socially now going to change our society? If we are all in this position where all we're concerned about is what is the best way to maximize our work to get a profit. And what Richard says is there are long-term consequences. I'm just going to throw these out. But what about the environment? What about the workers' mindset, the mentality of people who go in every day to do these mundane jobs? What happens when the work goes away? Because think of what happened to the auto industry when it automated. And all of those people, those were good jobs that people could have that would pay a decent living. And the robot took your job. It wasn't the immigrant. It was the technology. And so all of this is actually linking together. And all of this accounts for some of the anger we hear people, when we hear people talk about work and all the issues related to work. So as we run out of time, I want you to begin to think about this. We'll pick up here. What I decided to do is just kind of overlap the topics because we always will run out of time. But we'll pick up here and then we'll move on to talk about the long-term impact of this and how we experience this McDonaldization in our day-to-day, everyday lives. And I just want to mention, for those of you who tuned in late, I will be putting up a pretty detailed study guide. So don't freak out because there's so much material in our textbook. I will give you specific pages and ask you specific questions to lead you to the ideas that are going to give you the general idea of the sociology of work. So see you next week. And keep calling in and keep sending emails. I'm going to go to the hospital.